This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life.
You laid down your life.
That I would be set free.
That I would be set free.
Jesus, I sing for.
Jesus, I sing for.
All that you've done for me.
All that you've done for me.
Auld Lang Syne.
Auld Lang Syne. Okay, that's the tune of this thing. So you might want to just look at the words here, and we're just going to put the...
Take your mask off so we can hear you.
Okay, there you go. I'm trying to protect all of you. It's just a cold. So, your grace will never be forgot, your mercy all my life will be my soul's forever song, my story and my light. From mountaintop to valley low, through laughter and through tears, surely the goodness of my God will follow all the years. For all that you've done for us, for every battle won, we'll raise a song to bless your heart for all that you have done. In all our failures and regrets, you've always led us home. Redemption's arm has raised us up, our triumph in the storm. For all that you've done for us, and for every battle won, we'll raise a song to bless your heart for all that you have done. And this one, we'll just have Stephanie sing this because it takes, the melody goes a little bit different way. So you can just be in prayer or just look at the words or whatever. But we'll just let her sing that part. And then you'll come back in with that that chorus again, okay? It's that one. I think you'll find that you'll know it.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Father, as we step into your throne room, thank you for the privilege you allow us to be us, to worship you, to sing these wonderful praise songs. And I just pray that it's a sweet, sweet aroma to you. And Lord, as we start a brand new year, I pray, Lord, we just go together, praising your name wherever we go, telling people about your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, that we just be what you've created us to be, and that is your ambassadors, not only here in this room, but as we go out into this world. And we'll just give you praise in all things today. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Change. soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. My God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. For all that you have.
Okay. International Mission Board workers Justin and Camille Franson partner with a church, an American businessman, and an Iranian believer named Dana to minister in Southeast Asia to refugees waiting to be resettled. These refugees are primarily Afghanis, Iranians, but there are Somalians, Sudanese, and Ethiopian small groups as well. The beauty and effectiveness of the Francis and Dana's evangelism ministry is that it is done in community, as opposed to more traditional models of one-on-one evangelism. Many Middle Eastern and African cultures are communal, so learning in a close-knit group is highly effective. Of the roughly 7,000 Afghani refugees in the area, the Francis estimate that 500 have committed their lives to Christ in the past 5 years through the ministry of local and international churches. Christian ministries and outreach by International Mission Board workers and national partners. Lord, we thank you for the work that is being done in Southeast Asia by the Francis and Dana and their partners to the refugees in Southeast Asia, Lord. We thank you for protecting them and that they might be able to reach some native people there that can better reach their people, Lord. And we know that you are blessing your word that's being shared in this area, Lord, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father, as we have taken up tithes and offerings, again, Lord, I don't know what's in here, but you do. You know the hearts of the people who've given. You know what you've called us to do as a church and how you will use these funds, Lord, to bring glory and honor to your holy name. We'll just give you praise that you'll multiply it and use it, Lord, that others may know Christ and that we may be an influence in our city. Again, Lord, that people will know that this is a place they can come and hear the word, and hear great music, and we'll, Lord, we'll give you praise in all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. How you guys doing today? Are they always this quiet? Oh. Go to the first slide. You know anything about Jonah? You ever heard about Jonah and the whale? Jonah and the fish? No? Well, Jonah's a prophet back in the day. He said, arise. God told him to arise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. Basically, God told Jonah, go to Nineveh. I want you to preach to them so they can turn from their wicked ways. But Jonah had other ideas. The next slide, please. But Jonah rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord. You know what happened to Jonah because he tried to flee? You have any clue? He was swallowed. Go to the next slide, please. He was swallowed by a big fish. He said, Lord, prepare a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. So Jonah, to make a long story short, was trying to escape the Lord. The Lord made a fish, stuck him in the fish, and then go ahead and last slide, please. Next slide. And took him forcefully to Nineveh. And then Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. So basically it took him 3 days to get there. And he ended up going exactly where he didn't want to go because that's where God wanted him to be. Is that the last slide? Okay, I thought so. So basically the story of Jonah is, if God tells you to do something, go ahead and do it because you're going to end up doing it anyway. You understand? Just shake your head. Dear Lord, once again, we thank you for these beautiful kids. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would be with them and give them the courage to apply what they're learning in your lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Anything? Did anybody have a music they're going to sing? We're all good? All right. Means we'll get out here early. Good morning.
Good morning.
And Happy New Year to you. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'd ask you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 through 21. But before I get there, a couple of announcements to make. If you noticed in your bulletin, if you're part of the missions and outreach team or committee, whatever terminology you want to use, I would like for you to meet with me immediately after church. If you would like to serve on a missions and outreach committee or team, you can join us for that. This will be stuff like Vacation Bible School, doing the Mission Moments thing, planning some outreach events for this summer. That's the kind of thing that this team will be doing. And each week, I'll be meeting with a different team. And so, just so you know, House and Grounds or Building and Grounds, whatever you want to call yourselves, be meeting the next Sunday. And then we'll have put it in the bulletin, meeting with team. We're going to have a plan for 2022. We're not just going to show up and hope something happens. We're going to have some plans on accomplishing some things that God has called us as a church to do. So be in prayer about that. Be in prayer for our music. We're going to shift gears starting next week. And so just come be in anticipation of what God's going to do. Because right now I don't know what God's going to do. But he will show us in due time exactly what that's going to look like. So I will say this. If you want to sing special music or have an instrument you play and you want to do that, or if you have a story you want to tell, come see me or see Peter. We'll put that on the schedule. You have to do that. But the other part, right now, there won't be a worship team per se. We're working on that, reorganizing that. So just be in prayer for all those things. Be in prayer for our church as we reach into 2022. That we'll just see amazing things. Because one thing one of my favorite little things is called the definition of insanity. And most of you probably know what that means. And that's doing the same thing we've always done, expecting something different to happen. Well, guess what? We're not going to live in 2022 in the year of insanity. We're going to do different things knowing God's going to do something different. So just hold on. as I told somebody this last week, if you don't like where we're going, maybe you need to get off the ship. If you don't like where we're going, maybe you need to tell me to leave. Because that's my sermon next week, by the way. Why am I here? So I'll give you just an advanced part of that. So 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 21 says this. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin, for us that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So the title of the message today is New Creatures for a New Year. And the question that I ask, and I tell you this all the time, I ask myself when God gives me the scripture and gives me the word, and I have to ask myself the question, am I doing exactly what I'm asking you? And usually I have to deal with this before I ever bring it to you. So the question is, am I a new creature, and am I being transformed into a new creature? So you know this, a little bit of history. If you are a believer, if some point in your life you came to the understanding that something was missing and you understood that it was Christ, and some point in your life you came forward or you in your seat or pew or whatever, or at your home, and you said out to God, God, I am missing something, and I believe it's Christ, and I want to invite him into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. From that moment on, you are growing constantly. You are becoming new every day. You're becoming different. It doesn't just stop at that moment. When you said yes, when you got baptized, whatever situation you went through, it doesn't stop at that moment. You don't become the perfect Christian, the perfect follower of Christ. It is a daily process. I heard a sermon while I was in Kentucky, and I thought it was pretty interesting. It was sort of a contemporary type church that my daughter goes to. And you can tell everybody has a tablet or a phone, and they don't carry Bibles anymore. And so he said what he went through is he began to read the book of Revelation again, in which he absolutely despised because it's complicated, it's for futuristic, it's some stuff. But one passage he read was about the church that said, Jesus said to them, you have lost your first love. You remember that passage? I think it's in either 2 or 3 of Revelation. And he said what he went back to, several things he did when he first became a believer and when he first got in ministry, he actually went back and got his Bible out and began to read the pages. And so I'm not saying that's what you need to do if you grew up using a tablet or using a phone for your Bible, then that's fine. Get back to reading and praying each and every day. Because I think that's the problem in America today is that we come to church getting what we think we need when God gives it to us every day. So that's not in my notes. That's just a little extra stuff I'm giving you for free. Won't cost you anything extra. So the question is, are you being transformed into a new creature? If you are, what is new about you? And I had to think about that, especially this morning. I have to confess, I came in with a bad attitude this morning. I've traveled. I've been in a snowstorm in Kentucky, which, by the way, you never want to be in a snowstorm in the South because they have no clue. None. They shut down interstates, accidents happening everywhere. It's just crazy. They're not prepared for it. So that plus flight delays. When I left here the Sunday on the 26th, I didn't get into Kentucky till 2 o'clock in the morning because every flight was delayed. Ice on the runway, anyway. So, and then I tried to take care of 6 grandkids. So, you have grandkids, you probably can relate to what I'm talking about. So, and then get back here. Get here at 10 o'clock Friday night. My truck wouldn't start. Battery's dead. Had to call somebody to come get me. Got home, had 2 flat tires on my other vehicle. I broke the hose on the air compressor to pump up the tires. And it went downhill from there. So I want to thank Carrie and Stephanie and Kara. I think, is that right? That's her name? Because they led me to a place of worship. I don't know if you quite understand sometimes what music can do when we're singing praises, not performing, but singing praises. And by the way, this is not my notes either. So thank you for doing that, because it instilled in me to be in a place of worship. And thinking about the things that we need to look at and how we can lead this year becoming different than we were in 2021. Because I think until God takes us home, He's always telling us we need to grow. We need to be transformed. We need to have a renewing of our minds. We need to be different, especially in the world that we live in today. It's terrible. I mean, it really is. I mean, you don't meet anybody nice hardly anymore. You go into any store and somebody's mad because they didn't have that one thing they were looking for, and they're mad at the checkout person because they didn't do correct. But we can be the difference. I'm telling you, without any question or hesitation, Capitol Heights Baptist Church can be the difference in Pierce, South Dakota. I'm telling you, we can. Because we're Capitol Heights? No. That's just the name. Because we are followers of Christ and He is wanting to change us. By the way, if you didn't get it, that's the word reconciliation is part of that. So the question I had to ask myself after that question, am I still living in things from the past? That's okay if you have things in the past. There's no problem with that. But it goes back to the first point, are we going to be new creatures, or are we just going to be old creatures living back here? Now, I can tell you this story because she probably can hear me even though she's in heaven. My mother, when I moved here, every time I would call her, she would tell me all the old stuff. She was reliving stuff. Who her friends were, who had died, you know, I just kept getting that. Well, Buck, did you know so-and-so died? I didn't even know them. Why would I, you know? So she would tell me all this stuff. And then I got to thinking about how we are as believers. If we don't have a fresh testimony, if God hadn't done anything in our lives lately, we got a problem. I wish I had, I don't like it, but I wish I had an amen, oh me. But if we're not changing, we're living in the past, and we will never get to where God wants us to be. That makes sense? It does to me. So, are you living in the past? As believers, we should be constantly asking God to search us and reveal in us what is missing, what needs to change, and how we can be closer to Him. I tell you, that's my goal for 2022, is to be in a closer relationship with God. Whatever that means, if I need to read more, pray more, I don't know what all that means. I just want to be closer to Him. Bible says that all things are of God and He has given us His ministry. Isn't that pretty cool to think the God of creation, who created heaven and earth and created you and I, has given us a ministry that is His. He's entrusted us as believers to do His work. He could do it. I mean, He literally could just speak and everything would change. But he chose not to take that path. He chose to allow us who follow him to have his ministry. So if you believe this is a true statement, because I can tell you that a lot of believers have many ideas of what truth is. You go to this church and you get one idea. You can go to this church, you can have a different preacher speak from this pulpit, and you'll get a different idea. But let me tell you, this is the only truth. There is no other. There is no other. There is no preacher who can preach a different truth. It is right here. It's that simple. Now, while I don't understand everything in here, I understand what God allows me to understand and live it. Make sense? So if we're not in here, guess where your life's going to be? Dead batteries? No, just kidding. I'm just saying that we need to get back to our first love when we first accepted Christ, because I guarantee you every person in here, when they first got saved, they started praying, they started reading their Bible, they started engaging people with the gospel, and we stopped it. We're afraid we're going to offend somebody. We're afraid we're going to hurt somebody's feelings. Whatever excuse, and I've used them all, plus 500 other ones. So Scripture tells us that he has given us a ministry, and shouldn't we be doing what he tells us to do? I mean, it's pretty simple, right? If God says, this is what I've called you to do, go do it. And people like me will say, but God, you don't understand. Now, isn't that a stupid statement to make? But God, you don't understand. Well, he created me, so I'm guessing he does understand. So this next part that I'm going to be reading actually came out of a Google search for the word reconciliation. Because I was trying to think of what it was, and I'm trying to think all the meanings. And so I just Googled this. So you know, this is not original. You can Google the same thing and it'll come up. But here's what it says. Reconciliation comes from a Greek family of words that has roots in alasoeo. The meaning of common to this word group is change or exchange. Reconciliation involves a change in the relationship between God and man, and between man and man, or between woman and man, and between woman and woman. You get it. It requires change. It assumes that there has been a breakdown in the relationship, and now there has been a change from a state of enmity and fragmentation to one of harmony and fellowship. Let me tell you, the number one killer of churches in America today is inside the building. It's not outside. It's not necessarily theology. It is internal things that go on with people, because you've heard me say this before, pastoring would be easy if I didn't have to deal with people. And you laugh, but really I'm talking about all of us, because we all have problems, we're all sinners, we all fall short, but we need to understand that we can have unity and harmony in church if we're reading and praying and studying and loving one another like Christ loved us. Question I ask myself, would I lay my life down for you? And the first answer is probably no. But the second answer is yes. If I thought it would save you, I would literally lay down in front of a truck. Because I believe that's what God, I know that's what God did for me. He laid his life down for me. So if there's been a breakdown, the only way to do that is reconciliation. Because Paul says in Romans 5, 6 through 11, Paul says that before reconciliation, we were powerless, ungodly, sinners, and enemies. We were under God's wrath in verse 9. Because of change or reconciliation, we become new creatures. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. Reconciliation has to do with relationships between God and man, or man and man, and God reconciles the world to himself. That's in 2 Corinthians 5:18. Reconciliation takes place through the cross of Christ or the death of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:18 says that God reconciled us to himself through Christ. How did that happen? Through Christ. What did Christ do? He died. Why did he die? For you and I. Pretty simple. Thus, we are no longer enemies, ungodly sinners, and are powerless. Instead, the love of God has been poured out in the hearts through the Holy Spirit whom he has given to us. That's in Romans 5:5. It is a change in the total state of our lives. Reconciliation is the objective work of God through Christ. But it is also a subjective relationship. Be reconciled to God. Thus, it is Christ through the cross who made reconciliation possible. For God made him to be sin for us. You ever thought about that? Think about it often, especially around Easter when we observe the fact that Christ went to the cross. The Bible says that at one point in history, think about this. I know my sins. I don't know yours. I know mine, but mine are pretty enormous. Have been in my life. It's still today. There's still things I work on. But can you imagine at a moment in history when all the sins of the world, past, present, and future, were laid on him at one moment? That's pretty powerful to think that he became sin for you and I. Now again, if we just multiplied the sins in this room... And I know some of you. That would be enough to take the life of Christ. But it was not only our sins, but it was the sins of the entire world, past, present, and future. At one moment in time, he bore all of that for you and I. Reconciliation is also related to justification. God has reconcile the world, but not counting people's sins against them. Isn't that pretty cool that even though we're still sinners, God has already paid the price for that? He doesn't have to go to the cross next week, next year, next month, next hour. He's done it. He's already taken care of that. And if we understand what we are supposed to do when we come to the understanding of our sins, we come to him and ask for forgiveness. And the Bible says, as far as the east is from the west. Problem is, we don't forget. God does. We hold it against each other. We hold it against our neighbors, our friends. When somebody does something against us, we want to write it down in the book so a year later we can go back and say, remember what you did to me? I haven't got yet. But God says he does. Isn't that great that he forgets what we've done against him? Justification, not counting people's sins against them. It is related to justification in Romans chapter 5. It says, we have been justified through faith by his blood in verse 9. Reconciliation is also subjective in that the sinner is spoken of being reconciled. It is a relationship that comes between a man and wife as well as Jew and Gentile. If a person is about to offer a gift at the altar and remembers that he has something against his brother, the Bible says he should leave his gift and be reconciled first to his brother and then come and offer his gift. In other words, we really can't come to Christ if we're holding something against somebody else. Does that mean? The Bible says, you know, the Lord's Prayer, forgive trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. We can't come before a holy God when we're holding things back, when we're holding anger against someone. I just remember, I came up yesterday in the conversation, again, not my notes, but I was talking to somebody yesterday, and I said something. He said, man, you really stepped on my toes. And I said, well, I remember a story about my dad. You'd have to know my dad. He was, you just have to know my dad. But there was a revival preacher at our church, and he did preach the sermon, and my dad came down after the service and went up to the pastor and said, I should have wore steel-toed boots today because you really stepped on my toes. And the preacher said, well, I apologize. He said, because I was aiming for your heart. And I thought, what a powerful statement that is. Not stepping on your toes, but trying to connect with your heart. Isn't that what God is doing every day in our lives, is trying to connect to our hearts, trying to find out where we are and what needs to change in our lives? And it said they became one spirit, and we became one spirit by the reconciliation between us and God, between us and each other. And we need to understand that. It's no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God and members of the same household. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 through 22. Gentile and Jewish believers are reconciled to God, and the middle wall partition is broken. There are no separations anymore. When Christ came, he did all that for us. He broke down every single wall that would hinder us from working together, being unified in spirit, and carrying out the message and the cause of Christ. The message of reconciliation or salvation that has come from God passed on to us. God gave us the ministry of reconciliation. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. The ultimate aim is that we are not only justified, but that we might become the righteousness of God. Verse 21, if you remember when I read earlier, that we might become the righteousness of God. The whole message of reconciliation is centered around the love of God and the death of Christ. Paul reminds us that God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Before we were even known, Christ died for us, because he knew. Mom and Daddy may not know we were coming along, but God knew. And he had a plan. He had a plan for his son to come and live on earth. He had a plan for his son to go to a cross and to shed his blood for us. I'm reading in Leviticus right now, and it's pretty, I've read Exodus and Leviticus in my daily readings, and it's really interesting to think about all the animals that have been sacrificed. If you've ever read those books of the Bible, I mean, I was thinking Aaron and his sons must have spent 24 hours a day for all the sins that the Israelites had committed, because how many bulls did they have to do? How many sheep? How many goats? How many turtle doves? How many animals they did, and the whole process of what it was to do for you, the Israelites, and to cover that sin and peace offerings. And what it's if you have never read Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, read those. It's really an interesting reading. So Paul reminds us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This brings peace with God, access to God through Christ, rejoicing in the hope of the glory of God, making us rejoice in suffering. Boy, that's something new, isn't it? That as believers we should suffer for his name's sake. But it brings peace from God, and that we can have the love of God pour out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit. I think today in America and in the church, we miss that connection of the Holy Spirit. We're looking for something else. We're looking for this glorious revelation. God says it's right there. I've given it to you. If you're a believer, I've put the Holy Spirit in you by that act that you did, understanding that who I am, what Christ did for you. The Bible says that moment in time when we do that, the Bible said the Holy Spirit comes into our hearts. Now, I can tell you, again, from a confession standpoint, most of my life I have built a box, not a literal box, but if you understand what I mean, is Holy Spirit, here's how far you can go. I don't want you to go any further this way or this way or this way or that way. I want to do what I want to do, and I want to love Christ, and I want to be good, and I want to preach, and I want to do all these things, but I will only allow you to be this. One of my things that God gave me, and I don't know if somebody else coined it, but I say this to myself all the time: God, empty me of me and fill me with your Spirit. Empty me of me, because I know me. Empty me of me and fill me with your Spirit. I want to be that thing that you call me to be. So we can rejoice in knowing that God loves us and that we have access to Him through Jesus Christ, and we have now received reconciliation, Romans chapter 5, verse 11. So if that's true, all the things I just read you, all the things scripture-wise, the things I've just said, if those are true, and I believe it is, what is God asking us? As we embark on a new year, are we satisfied? Now, I'm going to give you an opinion. You understand what opinions are. It's just mine, not yours. I believe churches get content. Got enough money in the offering plate. Our money is more than we spend. So we've got money in the bank. We've got a pretty good crowd of people here. So we're okay with that. We've got somebody who will come and preach, and we're grateful for that. I'm grateful that you allow me to do that. But is that what God wants us to do for 2022 and beyond? I can tell you the answer. No. No. There are lost people in Pierce, South Dakota that need to hear the gospel. And the Bible says, if we don't tell them, how are they going to hear? So if we believe what we've just heard, and what is God asking us? He's asking us to reconcile us to Himself, and then He's asking us to reconcile us to Him, and then to the world through Him. How does that happen? One, we have to be bold and understand that if we are believers, the Holy Spirit will work through us. We cannot be afraid to go up to somebody and ask, do you know Christ? If you died today? Oh, Buck, you don't understand. I might embarrass somebody or offend them. I'd rather offend you than to know, because I didn't, you'll spend eternity apart from God. So my goal for 2022 is to make sure that I engage people with the gospel outside of here. To make sure that I spend time daily in prayer and daily in Bible reading so I can know God better. That I can draw closer to Him. And then that last verse, to me, it sort of speaks it all. We are ambassadors for Christ. Right? So what does it mean? What does an ambassador do? An ambassador engages people, tells them what they do, why they do it, who they are. And isn't that what we're supposed to be? If we're followers of Christ, shouldn't people know? Without us telling them, shouldn't they know that we're followers of Christ? The old wise spokesman said, if all else fails, use words. If all else fails, let's use words. Let's reconcile to God, reconcile to each other. Let's make 2022 the best year. Now, here I'm going to make a political statement, and you can like it, you don't like it, I don't really care. If you already know me, I'm going to tell you what I think, right? This is not about Corona. This is not about who's in office. While all those things are important, please don't negate those things are important. But if we're not about this, all that other stuff is garbage. We need to get back to our first love, and that's through Christ Jesus Himself. So, hang on, hold on, buckle up. We're going for a ride. And it's going to be a great ride, because I can tell you right now that I believe with all my heart that there's not enough seats in this room. And there's coming a day when you're going to hear an announcement from right here that we're going to second service and that we're going to do things a little bit different. We're going to do things different in our community. Not because Capitol Heights is on the name, but because we are followers of Christ. Not just Christians, but we're followers of Christ. God can still use us to change the world. He's not done with us yet, or we'd all be in heaven. Right? even though I want to go there. He's not done yet. And he says he can accomplish things. So I'm asking you a question, and then we're going to have a prayer and an invitation if that's what we need to do. But is God who he says he is? Is he a big God who can do big things, and yet we say, no, God, you can't? My goal for 2022 is God is a big God. And he can do exceedingly abundantly more than I can think or dream. And I can tell you right now, I'm dreaming big things. And I believe he can do it through us right here. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for who you are. Thank you that you love us in spite of us. That you did something for us we could not do for ourselves. You sent your son, your precious son, to hang on an old rugged cross, to shed his blood for forgiveness of our sins. And Lord, we just, right now, this moment, I pray that we're all in unity of spirit, that we have a task to accomplish, and that is to go out into this world and be your ambassadors like we've never been before. Lord, there are people you want to send here. I pray that we find those people, we invite them here, and Lord, you can just send whoever you want to send, because I can assure you today, Lord, that we will preach your word and that we will love people wherever they are. And we just lift all these things up in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have a need this morning, I invite you to come. Stand if you can. Sit if you must. And we'll go from there. The songs are on the wall there, and I think we've got somebody playing for us. I hope somebody's behind me. A whole bunch of them. Great. So I close my eyes when I pray, so I don't know who did what. So.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home. You're not too far. Lay down your hurt. And all those who've strayed, come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest not indoors. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. There's joy for the morning, sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow. heaven can heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are. Come as you are. Begin, come find your mercy. A sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, and rest what endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are lift up your face, O wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, as you
Father, as we have gathered in this place, we've heard your word. Lord, I pray that we take it to heart, that you fill us with your spirit, empty us, fill us with your spirit, and guide and direct us this week. And Lord, put somebody in our path that we may be able to show them the hope that we have through your Son, Jesus Christ. We'll ask you to do things that you can do. anticipate what you're going to do and join you as you work in our lives and the lives of this church, in the lives of our community and of our city and those surrounding cities. We'll just put all these things in your trustworthy hand. In Jesus' name, amen.